you could clean the dog. Colin is now feeding himself. Thanks, Megan.
Hi, Megan. No worries. We got it all cleaned up. Let's hope Colin gets past the spaghetti flinging stage soon. Till then, we've got you covered. See you next time, Merry Maids.
Free Motion e-bikes is rolling out its new line of Aventon e-bikes. Come in today and save $300 on the top-selling Aventon Adventure. Free Motion is Central Washington's home for affordable e-bikes, located in the Mills Brothers building in downtown Wenatchee.
Way swung on a fly ball.
Wenatchee Apple Sox Baseball is back on the NCW Live Channel. Join us Monday, July 17th as the Apple Sox host the Bend Elks. Coverage is brought to you by Apple Valley Honda, Confluence Health, JDSA Law, Merry Maids, Mini Blinds and More, Prestige Senior Living at Colonial Vista, Together for Youth, Wenatchee Valley Dispute Resolution Center, and Walkabout Grill. Your
We have gathered once again before the warmth of our television sets. On a warm Thursday morning, 6th day of July 2023, this is Wake Up Wenatchee Valley. Dan Kuntz, your host. Thanks for starting your day with us. We appreciate it. It's 64 degrees here in the big city. When I got up this morning, early, you know we get up real early, it was 70 degrees. So we cooled off a little bit. This is usually the coolest part of the day, right at an hour and a half after sunrise. And then we're going to warm right back up again. We'll be into the 90s. We had 91 yesterday. More haze today and a little bit of haze on Friday, but by Friday afternoon, the winds are going to shift pattern a little bit. They're going to pick up a skosh. They're also going to change direction, and that means the haze will be gone by Friday afternoon. That's the good news. The bad news is going to get hot. We're going to have, it's going to be a southerly flow. It's going to bring up some warm air from the south and really get us cooking. 100 degrees over the weekend. Not out of the question. It is July, so we have to, you know, a little grain of salt, or maybe a real big grain of salt with that. Your very warm forecast is coming up. It was a busy day in the newsroom. We have a lot of news stories to get to. Mariners lose. Their four-game winning streak has come to an end. They lost to the Giants last night, 2-0. The Mariners have not won five games in a row all year long, and they've only won four games in a row twice. They're back down below the 500 mark, and now they get to take on the Astros for four games before the All-Star break, and the Apple Sox with a chance to clinch the first half Northern Division title last night in Port Angeles didn't. So they and Bellingham are tied. The Apple Sox lost. The Bells won. We'll talk about the playoff scenarios when we get to sports. It's all down to tonight, essentially. Those details are coming up. It's Thursday. Pause for pets. Lilo the dog needs a home. We'll check in with our friends at the Wenatchee Valley Humane Society, and we're talking racing with Jeremy Anders, the general manager of the WVSO. If you can't make it to the racetrack on Saturday night, you can tune in and watch the races right here on the NCW Life Channel. Looking forward to that. Jeremy will be joining me in the back half of the program. We begin, like we always begin, with our tours, and that is the Wenatchee Heights camera. Well, we have it pointed almost due east. By the way, this was the first day so far this summer that sunset tonight will be before 9 o'clock, specifically 8:59, but the days are getting shorter in such a short increment that it's really hard to really make much of a difference. You can see the few clouds hanging out. There's the mighty Columbia eventually working its way towards the Pacific Ocean. So that is the Wenatchee Heights camera, but we're giving East Wenatchee and a little sliver of Rock Island a little bit of love on this Thursday morning. Another view of the Columbia River will go up quite a bit, up to the Stayman Flats area. The Columbia River looking out over the Douglas County area, really dominating most of it. You can see Mission Ridge way off in the upper left-hand corner of your screen. This is the Stayman Flats camera. That's decision time, heading up to Lake Chelan, whether you're gonna take the Navarre Coulee and dump yourself off on the south shore at the State Park, or head right on through the Knapp's Hill Tunnel and you get to the lake at Pat and Mike's. That's about that point on the highway from the Douglas, from the Chelan County side of the river. Billy Goat's looking good. We saw it at the start of the show. We're gonna look at it again, and you'll see the haze up in Billy Goat. Again, it's much closer to the Canadian wildfires than we are down here. And again, we remain in a rather northerly flow because there's that big upper level ridge that's stationed right off the coast of British Columbia, but it's gonna shift So we're going to have more haze, but it's going to get better as the week gets closer to the weekend. And finally, McNeil Canyon, as we check in with beautiful Chelan. Still a little hazy up there as well. Good morning to Chelan. It's a pleasure to see you folks on this Thursday morning. Did I mention we're going to go from warm to just plain hot? After 91 yesterday, we'll be a number of degrees warmer than that. And then we really get warm, in a general speaking, close to 100, if not 100, on Saturday. Sunday, I think we have a very good chance of getting to 100. We're going to cool down a little bit by the early part of next week. But Sunday is going to be probably the hottest day of the year so far. It is July. There is a weak chance of thunderstorms in some of our viewing area. Here in the Wenatchee Valley, our best chance of thunderstorms probably on Monday, as the atmosphere will become slightly unstable. So, from the National Weather Service, again, here we go, under the influence of that big dome of high pressure. But throughout the day today, there's going to be a gradual shift to a southwesterly flow, and that means any residual smoke that's way up in the atmosphere that's been blowing down from the north, from the fires in Alberta and from British Columbia, will clear out by the end of the week, because the wind is going to change direction. It's not going to be real windy, but it's going to be just enough to get the job done. But of course, it's also ushering in warm air from the southwest, and that means warmer temperatures. 91 yesterday, 95 today. Mild overnight lows. My air conditioner ran all night long last night, right around 70 for the overnight low tonight. Another degree warmer, but the haze will start clearing out by Friday afternoon. We'll top off to 96, and with no haze to filter the sunshine, close to 100 on Saturday, and I think 101 is definitely within the ballpark on Sunday before a gradual cooling trend on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Keep in mind, our normal high temperature this time of the year is 85. We'll be at least 10 degrees above that, if not more, throughout the forecast period. 6 minutes after the hour, grab a cup of coffee, come right back. We'll do the news. You're watching Wake Up in Wenatchee Valley on the NCW Life Channel.
Transform your windows with a variety of colors and styles like the Allure Transitional Window Covering by Lafayette Interior Fashions. Hi, this is Darren with Mini Blinds and More. We can install the latest and greatest in technology to open and close your blinds with only a touch of a button. From the largest windows in your home to room darkening shades for the bedroom, from stylish shades for your entertainment room to custom blinds for those hard-to-fit places, we have a solution for all of your window covering needs. We offer a variety of window coverings from Lafayette Interior Fashions. Call us today. We are Mini Blinds and More, your local blind store.
Clearwater Saloon and Casino has the best Vegas-style games in East Wenatchee. Come enjoy yourself and discover the nightly action. Win big and meet new friends at the Clearwater Saloon and Casino.
When your heating or cooling system is giving you trouble, call the diagnostic doctor from Dix Heating and Air Conditioning.
Here's the culprit right here.
All joking aside, when you call Dix, you're calling 35 years of experience at customer service right here in the Wenatchee Valley. Dix strongly believes in repairing before replacing, and they service all major brands of HVAC units.
VreeMotion e-bikes is rolling out its new line of Aventon e-bikes. Come in today and save $300 on the top-selling Aventon Adventure. VreeMotion is Central Washington's home for affordable e-bikes, located in the Mills Brothers building in downtown Wenatchee.
It has really been a great partnership between Succession and NCW Life. It's not always easy to sit in front of a camera or a microphone, but you guys have made it a really nice process.
Hazy sunshine, 64 degrees here in the big city, mid-90s today. Mid-90s on Friday with clearing skies, lots of sunshine, and very hot on Saturday, and especially on Sunday. It's 8 minutes after the hour. Kittitas County searchers yesterday located the body of a Leavenworth man who died one day earlier after jumping from a cliff into the Columbia River. Deputies identified the man as 22-year-old Liam James Gillikin of Leavenworth. Authorities say Gillikin leaped from the cliffs on the west bank of the Columbia River, just west of Crescent Bar, All right, about 8:15 in the evening on July 4th, the drop was estimated at 50 to 60 feet. Gilliken did not surface. Searchers began combing the river into nightfall. And then yesterday, teams using boats, a search dog, and an underwater drone found Gilliken's body submerged near the area where he jumped into the river. The King County Sheriff's Office provided rescue divers to help in their recovery. There will be an autopsy to determine the exact cause of death. Two people were hospitalized following a two-car accident yesterday afternoon. This happened on Highway 28 near Rock Island Dam. According to the Washington State Patrol, at about 3:30 yesterday afternoon, a 2002 Ford Explorer being driven by 46-year-old Jermaine J. Allen of Cashmere was traveling westbound near the bottom of the grade when a tire blew, and that caused the Explorer to cross the center line where it struck an eastbound 2008 Ford Focus head-on. Both the driver of the Focus, 20-year-old Alexander Cervantes of Morrow, Georgia, and his passenger, 60-year-old Carmen Blanquichoa of Quincy, were transported to the central campus of Confluence Health with undisclosed injuries. Allen was not injured. The man accused of killing two women and injuring three others outside the Georgia Amphitheater in that shooting last month has pleaded not guilty in the incident. 26-year-old James M. Kelly appeared Wednesday morning in Grant County Superior Court. He entered not guilty pleas to counts of first-degree murder and assault. Authorities say Kelly shot and killed Brandy Escamilla and Jocelyn Ruiz in a campground outside the weekend-long Beyond Wonderland Festival. He then allegedly began firing on two bystanders with a handgun, as well as severely wounding the 20-year-old woman who accompanied him to the concert. Kelly remains held in the Grant County Jail. He could face trial as early as next month. A Douglas County murder suspect had his first court appearance last week in after the Washington State Supreme Court ruled that a police search of his home was lawful. This case has been going on a long time. Ului Teoleo was charged with the murder of his wife Peggy 4 years ago, but he has yet to go to trial amid multiple appeals. Early last month, the Supreme Court threw out his argument that sheriff's deputies improperly entered his home when they found Peggy's body in July of 2018. Well, in Waterville on Thursday, Teolilo's lawyers indicated they might ask the Supreme Court to reconsider its opinion. A judge is due to schedule his trial date at the end of this month. A Wenatchee man is facing multiple charges after allegedly driving a passenger car into the side of a house. This happened near the intersection of Canyon Crest Drive and Western Avenue. Police say 24-year-old Nicholas Robert Jones was headed east in a 1998 Mazda 626 at about 6 a.m. on the 4th of July when he veered off the road and crashed over the sidewalk, through a fenced yard, and into the rear of the home. Jones then allegedly fled from the scene and was later arrested at his home. Police say he was driving on a suspended license. He's now been cited on charges of DUI and hit and run. It's that time of the year again. Ballots for the August 1st primary will be mailed out to voters, registered voters anyway, at the end of next week. Three candidates for Wenatchee mayor want your vote. NCW Life is airing interviews with those candidates all this week. In today's excerpt, News Director Jefferson Robbins asked each of the three mayoral candidates to introduce themselves.
My name is James McLaughlin. I'm originally from Ireland. I moved over here 13 years ago. I have three kids, and yes, I'm very proud to call this valley, this city, my home.
James, what's your line of work?
I am a builder, a general contractor. I've worked with the North Central Washington Builders Association. I'm actually a member, and I have spent the last 10 years to actually educate by actually working with folks and showing them that this is actually an honorable profession. A lot of people, when they think of builders and general contractors, they think of, you know, it's bad experiences, and I've worked tirelessly to change people's attitudes. I have worked with dignitaries. I had the honor to work for the President of Ireland on his personal residence. I've worked with Harriet Bullitt, and I've worked with a broad spectrum of people, and it's really helped me with negotiation, with communication, and you know, I've learned from all these tricks that these super successful people have.
I'm a Wenatchee native, so I've been here a couple of years. And currently, I was retired from the banking industry back in 2009, and then I started my own company's Proactive Business Solutions, and then about 5 years after that, Proactive Real Estate. And so currently, I started a mini storage on Maple Street Mini Storage. So I run those businesses out of my offices there. And I was on the city council back 2012 to 2016. Really enjoyed that time, getting to know the inside of city operations. And since I ran for mayor in 2016, and lost to the incumbent, darn it. When I did get off the council, one of the organizations I started was the One Wenatchee Group, and that's been Good Samaritans working for the public safety of the community. And we've done different projects. We've worked with the state on the George Seller Bridge safety issue there for pedestrians. We've worked with Chelan County PUD on keeping the bollards painted on the loop trail.
Well, first of all, I'm a family person. Grew up in Wenatchee and go off to college, East Washington University, and then come back. My wife and I, we decided where did we want to raise our children, and we both always loved this community. I have three daughters. All three live in Wenatchee. Two are special ed teachers in our school system here. And they're all over the age of 28, so this is the right timing for me. I was involved president of the Hospitality House, and I was a retired senior volunteer program in their organization, and this is all in the 90s and then 2000. I've been on the Tourism Promotion Area Board. Besides being on the City of Wenatchee, which is one of the boards they have, I was on it prior to that, and Lodging Tax Service. So it's been, it's something that I believe is inherent that you need to do this to give back to the community, and it's just the right timing. I prepared 4 years ago. Mayor Kuntz put me on a couple, like Schlandelg's Transportation Council. He knew that this was my aspirations. He knew that it was the right thing for me and my family to go forward. So he put me on some boards with all the other mayors in the region, and that's really been beneficial.
And finally, this area's former congressperson is throwing his hat in the ring. He's running for governor as a Republican candidate, Dave Reichert. He was the 8th District Congressmember for 14 years. Before that, he was King County Sheriff. The 72-year-old Reichert filed paperwork on Friday with the state's election campaign office to run for the governor's seat that's being vacated by Jay Inslee. He is one of 20 declared candidates so far to run for the office. When it goes on the ballot in 2024, they will certainly be more. And that's what's making news at 17 minutes after the hour. It's been a surprisingly busy news week. Well, that's what we do. We believe in an informed viewership. So if you want to know what the heck's going on in the Wenatchee Valley, North Central Washington, tune into the newscast with Grant Olson tonight at 5, 6, and 10, 5, 6, and 10 on television. Also available on the World Wide Web by going to our homepage, our Facebook page, or our YouTube page. And you can use, well, you can't use YouTube. You can use our email to get a hold of us, news@ncwlife.com. You can use our own page, ncwlife.com, or you can pick up the telephone and give us a call if you think there's something out there that demands our attention. When we come back, tough night for the Mariners, tougher night for the Apple Sox. Baseball takes center stage in 2 minutes. You're watching Wake Up Wenatchee Valley on the NCW Life channel.
Hey, hon, would you run us around to the wash rack?
Oh, okay.
Hey, hon, what happened?
They shrunk the truck.
The all-new midsize Canyon is now available at Sangster Motors.
I had had a seizure in the middle of the night, and they rushed me to the hospital and decided to induce labor to try to get the baby out. The outpouring of love and support I got from Confluence Health, my coworkers coming to the ICU to be with me. For me, it's the work family. It's just incredible to have support no matter what I'm going through in my personal life, my own health.
D.A. Davidson in Wenatchee provides financial services for independent-minded clients working to secure their futures. Whether it's helping construct your personal financial, retirement, or estate plan, they start with a disciplined approach and straightforward advice. An individualized approach is rooted in the values, stability, and strength their company was founded on in 1935. With offices coast to coast and personal attention you deserve right here in the Wenatchee Valley, learn more about D.A. Davidson.
Minutes after the hour in sports, the Mariners' four-game winning streak came to an end last night with a 2-0 loss to the San Francisco Giants in San Francisco. Alex Cobb had 7 strikeouts and 6 crisp innings of work. He combined with 3 relievers to hold the Mariners to just 7 hits.
Leo replacing Yordan Alvarez on the American League All-Star team. That was great news yesterday. Great to see that clubhouse scene with Scott Service playing the All-Star game back home in Seattle.
Swinging a line drive in a left center field. That's going to be in there for a base hit. Hard hit ball off the bat of Julio off of Cobb. Up of the ball is Slater, gets a throw into second base. So one on and one away.
This ball stays at the knees off the board with a base hit.
Brings up Teoscar Hernandez at 10 plus hits in 4 consecutive games.
Here's a ground ball right to Casey Schmidt. They knew what they were doing. He fields, flips to Crawford, 1. His throw to first, got him double play. Beautifully turned and great positioning by the Giants there.
Well, it was a break. That was going to be one, maybe even a double play. Now you got an inning set up.
So here's Lamont Wade Jr. starting to carry Rodriguez underneath it. And that'll be enough easily for Crawford to score. And the Giants lead 1-0.
Hey, good job by Lamont Wade Jr. to get the Giants on the board.
Yeah, that was a big league at bat right there.
Big spot here. Leadoff double. Now 2 down. Alex Cobb's got a chance to get through it. J.P. Crawford, though, doubled his last time up.
A sharp ground ball. Schmidt's got it. Off his knees, he throws, and they got him.
Opportunity here for the Giants. They already lead 1-0. They could use some more. 2-1 out. Lamont Wade, who hit a sacrifice fly his last time up.
Drive into center field. Rodriguez on the move. Rodriguez backed out. Dropped it! He dropped it on the warning track. Slater had to go back. Now the throw goes into Wong. He has no idea where to go with it. And coming in to score is Slater.
Talk about the wind that can really play havoc with a ball in the outfield. And this looked like a pretty benign chance for the sure-handed Rodriguez. He just takes his eye off the glove at the last second. Watch the eyes. See if it follows it in the glove. And it doesn't. He takes his eye off it.
So here's Rodriguez. Single in the first. Rolled out to third.
That one, though, was hit hard to center field. Matos will catch it at the wall. And then the ball comes out of his glove. So he couldn't squeeze it. He had it. Something weird's going on in center field right now.
Let's see if Gino can pick it up. Runner to second. They got a leadoff double here in the sixth. Change that story up a little bit here.
On the ground, Davis has it. Davis got him at first. It's been a splash of cold water on him with Alex Cobb and company.
Giants one out away from salvaging a win in this 3-game series. Giants fans going to stand up all around the ballpark. It's Jared Kelnick trying to keep the game alive for the Mariners. Kelnick strikes out swinging. 99-mile-an-hour fastball ends it. The Giants win the game. They take the...
Julio Rodriguez is going to the All-Star game despite the fact he dropped that fly ball. He had a couple of hits, so did J.P. Crawford and Cal Raleigh. Tommy Malone, who was called up from Triple-A Tacoma before the game to take the rotation spot of Bryce Miller. Miller is injured. Malone struggled with his control, matched his career high of 4 walks. The lefty pitched with runners on base in each inning, and he allowed 2 runs on 4 hits in 4 1/3 innings. The Mariners all-star right-hand pitcher George Kirby takes on the Astros tonight in the opener of a 4-game series in Houston, and that takes us to the all-star break. The Wenatchee Apple Sox rallied back from a 3-0 deficit to tie the game, but in the end, they lost to the Port Angeles lefties 5-3 on Wednesday night in Port Angeles. So the loss drops the Apple Sox to 19-7, and that ties them with the Bellingham Bells for first place in the North Division with 1 game remaining in the first half for both teams. So it comes down to tonight. Here's the scenario. If the Apple Sox win, they clinch the North Division's first half playoff berth. Even if Bellingham wins, the two teams will have the same record, And the first tiebreaker is head-to-head. Well, these two teams haven't played each other. The second tiebreaker is the run differential. And Wenatchee's is plus 62. Bellingham's is plus 33. So the Bells must win and the Apple Sox must lose for Bellingham to earn the North Division first half title. Port Angeles was shut out on Tuesday for the second time in the first four games of the season series with Wenatchee, but they guaranteed they wouldn't be shut out again. They sent eight men to the plate and they scored three times in the first inning. Quincy Vassar struck out a season high seven hitters in five innings. He recovered from a rocky start to fire at least five innings for the fourth time in all of his starts this summer. Two Apple Sox errors and a sacrifice fly in the bottom of the seventh helped score the two go-ahead runs for Port Angeles. So Wenatchee goes for the road series victory, the season series victory, and the first half title tonight against Port Angeles. First pitch at 6:35. So here are your standings as we head into the final game of the first half. Again, Wenatchee and Bellingham are tied at 19-7. If Wenatchee wins tonight, doesn't matter what Bellingham does, Wenatchee will clinch the first half title of the North Division and punch their ticket to the playoffs. If Wenatchee loses and Bellingham wins, Bellingham wins it. If both teams win, Wenatchee wins it. So the odds are pretty good, but we'll just have to wait and see. Victoria has already been eliminated, as you see. So there are your standings heading into the last game of the first half of the season. And those are just some of the games that people are playing at 26 minutes after the hour. Happy National Fried Chicken Day, baby. Bring it on. Fried chicken. We eat a lot of it. We eat about 10 million chickens every year just in the United States. And believe it or not, fried chicken comes from two completely different cultural and geographic locations. Half of it Scottish immigrants and half of it West African slaves. Scottish immigrants would take chickens, frying unseasoned chicken in fat. West African slaves would fry their chicken in palm oil. And in the American South, they kind of took the best of both and called it good. Now, of course, chickens were bred and raised to do one thing, pretty much one thing only, lay eggs so we could have eggs. Nobody really thought much about eating chicken, but the slaves back in the antebellum period, once the chickens were no longer able to lay their eggs, they were given the chickens. You could just have the chickens and the slaves would butcher them and fry them because they traveled well. Fried chicken lasts a long time and they needed that back in the day, considering that, of course, restaurants wouldn't serve them. So fried chicken became a staple of the diet in the South. And now, of course, it doesn't matter where you go, chickens in the supermarket are bred for one thing and one thing only, to eat. You don't see chickens in the supermarket that were bred to lay eggs. All of them were bred to do one thing only, and that's to cook them and eat them. Happy National Fried Chicken Day. Easy to make. You can make your own special sauce, or you can just go to the restaurant, fried chicken. Anything you can eat with your hands, I'm a big fan of. That's why I love spaghetti so much. 27 minutes after the hour. Today in history. It was supposed to be a one-off deal. Arch Ward was the sports editor of the Chicago Tribune. The mayor of Chicago said, hey, can you organize something to bring attention to Chicago during the Depression in 1933? So Arch Ward came up with the All-Star Game. We'll pick in the middle of July. We'll get the best players from the National League, the best players of the American League. We'll get them together for a one-off game. We'll hold it at Comiskey Park. We'll give all the money to charity, specifically former professional baseball players who were down on their luck, and we'll call it good. But it became the All-Star Game. The All-Star Game. The first one ever. Here is footage. John McGraw comes out of retirement to host the National League. Connie Mack of the Athletics was the manager of the American League. Huge crowd on hand. There's legendary Jimmy Fox, first baseman for the Athletics. The American League wore their own uniforms. National League had special uniforms. There's the Babe. There's Lou Gehrig getting ready for the game. So you can see the American Leaguers wore their actual uniforms. The National Leaguers wore special uniforms just for this game. And of course, the game would have to have a home run by the Babe. Babe Ruth hits the game-winning home run. The American League defeats the National League 4-2 in the very first Major League Baseball All-Star Game at Comiskey Park in Chicago 90 years ago today. Good idea. It was so popular, they kept doing it. Only 2 years, they didn't have an All-Star Game. 1945, at the height of World War II, and during the COVID year. There was no All-Star game, and of course the 93rd All-Star game will be in Seattle on Tuesday, the All-Star game. Now, all the leagues have All-Star games. NBA, NFL has the Pro Bowl. Anyway, the very first All-Star game in any sport held in the state 90 years ago today. 81 years ago today, Anne Frank and her family realized they better go hide, or the Nazis were going to come get them, and so they did. In the secret annex behind her father's office in an Amsterdam warehouse, behind that bookcase was a secret passageway to where they lived. It was 450 square feet. That was it. And it was eight people. Eight people lived in a room 450 square feet in size. But as Anne Frank mentioned in her diary, it was luxurious compared to where some of the other people were living. Anne Frank and her family going to hiding on this day, July 6th, 1942, and would stay there for the next couple of years. This is the 79th anniversary of the Hartford Circus Fire, Hartford, Connecticut, Ringling Brothers, Barnum and Bailey Circus in 1944. The footage is rather sobering as you look at it. Packed house. They had just brought in the wild animals. Two of the four exits were blocked because that's how they got the animals in and out of the circus ring. Something started the fire. To this day, they have no idea how the Hartford Circus Fire got started. Panic ensued. Some people just sat there, assuming they'll put the fire out. They burned to death. Other people were trampled to death. And when it was all said and done, 168 people died. Over 700 people were injured. One of the worst fire disasters in this country's history, the Hartford Circus Fire on a hot summer night, July the 6th, 1944, in Hartford, Connecticut. And finally, on a much different note, simple twists of fate. July 6, 1957, 66 years ago today, John Lennon's band, The Quarrymen, were one of the musical entertainment in Liverpool at the Wilton Fete, a Sunday afternoon get-together, cookouts, bands, parties, sports games, the Wilton Fete. Among the entertainers, The Quarrymen, featuring their leader, John Lennon. In attendance, Paul McCartney. When they weren't playing, Paul McCartney, a mutual friend, introduced Paul to John. They didn't know each other. John was about a year and a half older than Paul. Paul was impressed that John Lennon had his own band, his own skiffle band. John was impressed that Paul knew how to tune a guitar. John had to pay somebody to tune his guitar. He didn't know how to do it. They became immediate friends, and within a week, Paul McCartney was in The Quarrymen. John and Paul met on this date in 1957, and we do birthdays. Celebrity birthdays. Heavenly birthday, Merv Griffin, the first billionaire in entertainment history. Of course, he created Wheel of Fortune. He created Jeopardy, had his own talk show, and then invested heavily in Southern California real estate, casinos, resorts, what have you. Sold all of his properties for a bunch of money. Died, I think he was worth like $1.5 billion when he died in 2007 at the age of 82. Merv Griffin, the first billionaire in entertainment history. He did all right for himself. He was born in the state in 1925. So was Bill Haley. Rock around the clock. See you later, alligator. Bill Haley, whose Rock Around the Clock was the first rock and roll record to explode across this country. Extremely popular in Europe. With the rise of Elvis, of course, Bill Haley's popularity fell off here in the United States. He eventually died broke and alone at the age of 55 in 1981, but he is in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Living birthdays, two exact contemporaries. They were born on the exact same day, 77 years ago today. The 43rd president of the United States, George W. Bush, is 77. Like a lot of presidents, since he has left office, his popularity has increased. And Sylvester Stallone, also 77. You think they know that they share the exact same birthday, their exact contemporaries? I don't know. Sylvester Stallone, also 77. Rocky Balboa. John Rambo, Barney Ross. He also directs, of course. He directs almost all of the stuff he works in. Sly is 77 years old today. All right, 33 minutes after the hour. Still to come, an opinion from Mike Mad Dog McNaughty. It's about local business. We're talking racing with Jeremy Anders. Another great card of driving fast and turning left at the WVSO on Saturday night. Jeremy will be joining me. But first things first, Lilo the dog needs a home. It's Paws for Pets.
Hi, I'm Corley with Wenatchee Valley Humane Society. I'm an animal care coordinator here, and this little spunky husky mix is Lilo. She's a husky, so while being 10, she still does have some energy, but most of the time she really loves to relax. You'd never know it right now, but she's a very chill dog normally, and she's just kind of looking for her soft place to land. Ideally, we think that her ideal home would be with, maybe with a couple kind of around her own age. You know, not 10, but you know what I mean. And as a single dog, you know, the only pet, because she wants all of your attention. And she is our sweetheart here. She is a staff favorite. She loves playing, and she loves fetch and her stuffed animals, and she loves spending time with people. She's very social with us. She's just a really great, fun, she's very small husky too, but she's just a really great companion. So come down and meet her and, you know, throw the ball for her and give her some scratches and take her for a walk. She's very good on leash. And we are open all day between 11 and 6 p.m. Thursday through Tuesday.
Give them a call at 509-662-9577 or visit their website at wenatcheehumane.org.
So, how's Evan?
Well, he's all grown up now, but I worry about him.
So many dangers in the world. COVID, the environment, the opioid epidemic.
Yeah, I hear opioid misuse is on the rise.
I don't even know how to start a conversation with him.
This might help. GetTheFactsRx.com. There's a whole section on how to talk about opioids with your family.
Offer support, not judgment. Cool.
Talk to your family about the dangers of opioids. Visit GetTheFactsRx.com.
Welcome back to Save Mart. What can we help you find today?
We're looking for a mattress.
Oh, right this way. We got a large selection. We have this pillow top here.
Oh, comfortable.
We have more to choose from down here.
Oh.
I think I have the perfect one over here for you.
I guess we'll take this one.
You find it at Save Mart. Full service at a low, low price.
JDSA Law is a proud sponsor of these local event broadcasts. JDSA Law has been serving North Central and Eastern Washington since 1946. For over 70 years, their team of dedicated professionals has delivered quality, innovative legal services. JDSA Law partners with you to provide the finest legal advice and support as you navigate your personal and business challenges, your risks, and your accomplishments. JDSA Law supports the TV broadcasts of these local community events.
Thanks to Les Schwab Tires, I'm a confident backseat driver, but mom's a little stressed about spending. Remember, deep breaths and watch your speed. Even though we're watching our wallets, Les Schwab is still watching out for our safety. So turn here.
Hurry in and save up to $200 on a set of four tires, plus get an extra $50 off with financing. Les Schwab Tires.
Mike Mad Dog McNatty, and everybody is entitled to my opinion. Now, Amazon, the mega giant consumer retail business that's literally changing our society. Now, some people hate that beast. Now, Amazon is supposedly driving up housing costs in Seattle, paying people slave wages, yada, 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 yada. Well, maybe they are doing that, but you have to admit, Being able to find exactly what you want from the privacy of your own home and have it delivered in a day or two, that sure beats driving all over town looking for something that possibly no real retailer even has in stock. And quite frankly, the deteriorating customer service that is rampant in some retail businesses may be a big part of the reason why Amazon is so popular. Hmm. This is Mike Mad Dog Magnotti, and that's my opinion.
At Washington Trust Bank, can't is a four-letter word.
I think we should hire more people.
Doc, late for a meeting.
Hey, we need to build a home office. We're adding another bathroom.
We need a warehouse.
I can't imagine how we do that.
We believe you can do whatever you set your mind to, and we'll help you get there. Washington Trust Bank, privately owned, locally invested.
Dear Merry Maids, please clean the kitchen and the cabinets and floors and the chairs. And I wish you could clean the dog. Colin is now feeding himself. Thanks, Megan.
Hi, Megan. No worries. We got it all cleaned up. Let's hope Colin gets past the spaghetti flinging stage soon. Till then, we've got you covered. See you next time, Merry Maids.
My car's making a funny noise.
Not a problem. We'll take care of you.
Global Car Care's technicians are ASE Master Techs and well-versed in the more refined methods of vehicular diagnostics.
Number 3 piston and rings have a slight loss of compression, down to 108 pounds.
Your transmission is slipping. You're gonna need a service.
Looks like you're all set.
These guys? They're good.
Oh, and your spare's flat.
Global Car Care, Wenatchee's top shop.
Welcome back to the program. Drive fast, turn left. I'm all for it. I will be there Saturday night. You should be there Saturday night when Wenatchee Valley Super Oval, another full slate of racing. Our cameras will be there. We'll have it on television, or as we like to say in the business, TV. And here to talk about Saturday night, big friend of our program, big friend of the station, a man whose impact on local racing is so immeasurable, nobody's even bothered to try to measure it. Of course, talking about our good friend. Give it up for... Oh, crap. Jeremy Anders, everybody. It's nice meeting you, by the way.
Nice meeting you, too. First time.
Go ahead.
I'm just waiting, by the way. When do I get a parking spot? I pulled in today. I can't get a parking spot.
Hey, we're it's a popular
place. Reserve with my name on it, right?
Yeah, you should, as a matter of fact.
Do you have one of those?
No.
No? Okay.
No, I don't.
Well, I'll probably get one before you.
I walk to work. That's why I'm in such great shape.
Okay. There you go.
Is it me or crowds like up this year?
We're coming off a record June, quite possibly one of the biggest Junes ever in the history of the track, one of the biggest months ever in the history of the track. We had June 3rd, the Wenatchee 200, which is a big event. We talked about it all year long. It was going to be a huge event, and it ended up being record crowd, one of our biggest crowds we had on record in the last 24 years. Then we popped in. We had our Bunta Pass night, which is always a big crowd. You know, it wasn't sold out. It was pretty packed. And then we had Big Rigs after that in the month of June. The Big Rigs crowd was probably 95% sold out. So, I mean, we were kind coming off just huge crowds. So it's been really good all year long. We had one weekend where weather kind of hurt us a little bit, and weather will, I mean, if it's down 10, 15 degrees, it'll cost you 400, 500 people or so.
And it ain't going to be the problem on Saturday. I guarantee you that.
So it's been really good this year. The buzz is out there pretty strong. Our racing's been great in all of our divisions. Car counts are up for most of our divisions this year, so we're excited about it.
And the racing has been good. It's been an unbelievably clean year. Knock on wood.
Knock on wood, it's been clean. So I thought we've had a couple of hiccups here and there with a couple of our classes, but it's been good racing all year long. People, you know, we've had some close finishes. I think we've had three different times this year that we've had finishes called at the line that were within like a few feet of each other. So I thought, so that always makes for great racing for the fans and the drivers.
How do the guys in the booth know who's, it's a quarter mile oval, so it only takes 10, 12 laps, regardless of how many laps they're going to run. And I can easily lose track of who's it. Now, you got the scoreboard, the new one, by the way. I love the scoreboard. That's nice.
It's not new. It's just
refurbished.
Refurbished in some sense.
But
yeah.
How do the folks know who's, is it the transponders in the cars? How is that?
Yeah, so, you know, back in the day, they used to have line scoring. So there'd be like two people in the tower, and they have these charts, and they're marking down each time they're coming across the line, you know, each like that. They'll mark down like the time of the clocks like that. And when they had big races, and there's like 24 cars, they used to have these, every driver had their own like hand score who would like write down the time of when they'd crossed off the lap. So that way, if there's a score discrepancy, they go back and say, oh, well, you crossed the line at 4 minutes and 3 seconds on lap four. You say you crossed it here, well, who was telling the truth there? But that was, you know, now we have transponders, so it's this little like little electronic device. There's a scoring loop that goes across right at the start finish line there, so it reads it each time it goes by, and there's a computer system there, which also helps. So like when we do like the live ticker for like the broadcast, it needs to be live, or if people are from home or watching, or just like the crew wants to keep track, okay, like, hey, you're running a 13 second lap right now, and Joe Smith is running a 13.2, so you're gaining on him each and every lap. So it tells you to kind of help figure out the drivers too.
And where are the transponders located in the car? Is it, I suppose, as close to the front as possible?
No,
they have to be in the same location, right?
Yeah, so like the right, like behind the right rear wheel.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. But they all have to be there, because it wouldn't be fair if somebody had theirs on the hood, somebody else was on the front.
There has been times that people have moved them in different locations like that, so it's been called
That's
about.
That's called cheating.
That. Yeah.
Yeah, so, supposed to. Of course. It's right, the old line, if you ain't cheating, you ain't trying, right?
So right rear behind your rear axle, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
When I saw the 182-200 and you put out the call on social media and everywhere, you said, get your tickets in advance, carpool. And I thought, this is a bit hyperbole from Jeremy. And then you sent the picture on Sunday morning of the packed stands. I thought, where the hell did you put all those people? It must have been. I mean, for your staff and everything, that must have been just one crazy night.
Yeah, so we, you know, with those races, they have the bigger semi-truck haulers for that. So sometimes when you have those big races, they don't have as many haulers, so you can kind of use them in the area where you park the haulers for extra parking for that. But those guys all use these big semi-truck haulers. Plus, we had a lot of cars for other divisions, so the hauler area was pretty much packed. We had probably 60 or 70 campers, RV trailers up there filling up the area. And then we pretty much used every square inch of property we could to put cars on. We used areas which was usually our overflow camping area. We use that for parking, and then they parked alongside it. And then they actually end up parking all the way out to Fancherfield Road, all the way along there, like that, into the neighborhoods. And, you know, our neighbors were good to us about that, so I reached out to a few of them afterwards. But it was pretty cool to see. I mean, we haven't seen that for a long time. We'll get out to the outside the gun club gates and the main parking lot there, but to go that far out was pretty cool to see. And nobody complained about it. They knew how big of an event it was. Mm-hmm. They knew how special this was to have this event here. And the cool thing is we're already in the planning stages of next year to bring the event back and make it even bigger next year. I don't know how we can make it bigger, but we're going to make it bigger.
You're going to have to build more stands is what you're going to have to do.
Build more stands,
yeah.
But we're going to make the event we're going to make it so, I mean, hopefully tickets start selling out a week or two in advance, just so, you know, it was probably the most well-attended race so far in the Northwest this year. We had people from all over, not just the drivers, but the fans from all over the Northwest and West Coast comes like that, and, you know, the 2 or 3 days afterwards, I had people texting me who were drivers who said, hey, I'm coming to race next year, I should have been there this year, and then I had fans said, hey, I'm going to come next year. Like, I'm going to get on my bucket list. Like, this is the track I want to come to. And those are fans from California and people from all over. So it's cool to see.
Let's run through the card, if you will, on Saturday night. Again, our cameras will be there, but you want to be at the to get to feel the racing. Is you got to be there. The Zero Handicap Youth Roadrunners, are they running on Saturday?
Yeah, so it is kids night. It is right. Our Dixie Racing kids night. So we really pump up the kids. We just released. We're giving out the first 200 kids that come get a poster that actually features all of our youth division drivers on it, which is really cool. So yeah, the Zero Handicap Youth Roadrunners, they're in action, which that's our newest division this year, which is the Roadrunners, but it's, these kids are 12 to 16 years old, and they've had some great racing this year, a lot of side-by-side racing, very close pack and group of cars.
I have a lot of them graduated from Bandoleros up to that level?
Actually, not one has gone from Bandoleros. Really, it's kind of you either go the Bandolero option or you go the Roadrunner option. I think we might see one or two of the Bandolero kids go over there. Tyler Steinberg, he was in Bandoleros before he graduated over there, but the other kids are either they're right into racing or they're coming up from other divisions like that. You see a lot of Bandolero kids will jump into Legend cars next, and that's just the transition there. And then you see a lot of the Roadrunner kids might jump into a Thunder car. That's kind of what the transition usually happens. But the nice thing about the Roadrunner is once you're in that Roadrunner, that car is just easily converted to the Plum Perfect adult Roadrunner. So you can just run that car. And actually, we have some where the parents are running the car and the adults and the kids running the car.
Right, we've seen that, yeah.
So that happens there. So it's a lot of fun for those kids.
WMRA Midgets, right? They're going to be there?
Yeah, we got Midgets and Dwarfs both on Saturday. The AMCA Dwarfs and the WMRA Midgets. So I actually got a phone call about it, but I'm like, they've been the name of those racing classes for over, I mean, the WMRA Midgets have been around. I think they're one of the longest running classes in the Northwest. I think it's like 70 years like that. So they've been kind of hurting on car count the last couple of years like that. They're really fast. I mean, those little tiny cars are, I think they weigh about 1,200 pounds. So that they fly around the track. So they're a lot of fun to watch.
And then, of course, the Bandoleros, as we mentioned already, which is always my favorite because I love the Bandoleros.
The Angel Belbons Bandoleros, they're a lot of fun. Those kids, 7 to 14 years old, and I think there's a couple out-of-towners coming in this weekend, so it should make for a lot of fun.
The AMCA Bandit Dwarf cars, you mentioned that. The Plum Perfect Road Runners, that's the next level up there.
Yeah, that'd be the next level for the youth road runners to go into. We've been averaging 20 cars in those class, and that's been a very tight fill of the group. And the breakout rule has really made some interesting races this year. So the breakout rule is they can't go past that 16.750, and so guys are having to add weight to their cars or just slow their cars down a little bit to figure it out. Because I think last race we had somebody run a 16.751, and we had somebody run a 16.750, which is still not below it. So that's all they're putting right on the line there.
And that's a smart move. I mean, that's the way it should be.
Yeah.
Yeah. What we're talking about is that your car is only supposed to be able to go so fast. And that's the way it should be.
And we do it so people don't go overspend in that class. We don't want people spending $10,000 on Roadrunners like that. So it just kind of keeps everybody on a level playing field.
Finally, the headliner, the Dixie Heating and Air Conditioning Thunder Cars, will wrap up the night.
Yeah, so we have the Thunder Cars for the Can-Am Challenge. So we have quite a bit of out-of-town drivers come in from Canada and some of the other tracks. And so we've been averaging like 19 cars this year for the Thunder Cars. So I think we're going to be quite close to mid-20s to high 20s in this year. I think it's 2,000 win for those guys, so it should be a good race.
What do you hear from your friends in Monroe and over at State Line and up in Skagit? How are they doing?
I think everybody's doing really good. We actually we went over to Skagit for Dirt Cup weekend, and they had a really good race over there. They're doing some great things. They have a new ownership group that took over last year. State Line just came off a sold-out crowd last night for their July. They do their 4th of July a couple days different than ours. So, and then they have... they've had some great car counts along the way there. They have some of their bigger events coming up. Tri-Cities is kind of they're doing an extra race actually this weekend. Monroe had a huge crowd for their 4th of July celebration, and they've had some big races there. They have a big race coming up in Summer Showdowns like that. So everybody so far is going really good with that. I think we're seeing a little bit of economy stuff hurt maybe a little bit on some of the car counts and some of the races with that, but you know, we've been lucky so far that we haven't seen it affect us too much. So. We're hoping that we can keep it going that way.
And it's good to have Tri-Cities back, isn't it?
It's good. I think it's good. It's good for racing in the Northwest to have. We don't want to lose tracks. There's actually a brand new track that's just opening down in the Boise area, like right north of Boise. So, and it's a paved asphalt track like that. So, anytime we have a new track in the Northwest, it's a little ways away, but it's still in the Northwest. It's always good. So. You know, I think that, you know, it helps to have those tracks. I mean, you know, think of back in the day, we're about 10 tracks less than we had 20 years ago, so.
But it should be pointed out that when Tri-Cities shut down for a brief period of time, it was a few years anyway, they at least kind of maintained the footprint, so they figure, hey, if we're going to reopen, we're not starting from scratch. It wasn't like a bunch of weeds.
They pretty much started. The only thing they had that really was there was the track surface. Everything else they had to redo. I mean, they had to put. They're still adding little things here at a time down there for that. So, you know, it's very rarely do you have somebody come in like, you know, when The Evans family did it 24 years up here. They came and just said, okay, we're leaving the track. We're going to clear out, do everything else, refresh with that. So it takes a while to do that. And if you do it just one time, like, all at one time, it's a lot of money to do. So, yeah.
So once again, to recap, this is in order, right? The Zero Handicap, Ruth Roadrunners, the Midgets, the Angel Bail Bonds, Bandoleros. I love how a Bail Bonds company sponsors the race that kids run in. The AMCA Dwarf Cards, the Pump Perfect Roadrunners, and the Dixie Heating and Air Conditioning Thunder Cars. Gates open at 4:30, racing at 6.
Gates open at 4:30, racing at 6. It's kids' night, so all kids 12 and under get in free. Plus, we're giving away bikes. Last year we gave away.
How do you swing that?
Last year we gave away over 100 bikes. So we have a bunch of our sponsors who, Dixie and Air Conditioning is one of our title sponsors. They jump in and help us on it. We buy Walmart Wenatchee gives us a good discount. So we buy a bunch of bikes from there. And then a bunch of our race teams, they jump in and they buy bikes as well. And we have a few other donors. So last year we gave out over 100 bikes. The year before gave out, I think, like 85 like that. So I'm getting to pick up, I think, our third load that I'm going to go pick up today that will fill up our bikes. And so we're hoping to give away close to 100 again.
Wouldn't it be cool if you let the kids out on the track with the bikes?
They used to do that, but the problem is you can't get them off. You can't get them off the track. Once they get on the track, they're not off the track. Yeah. And then I don't want to be the guy running around, Looperville, trying to chase down a kid on a bike.
Yeah. It's hard enough to babysit the crew that work there at the Wenatchee Valley Super Bowl. That's the last thing you need on your deal. Greg Rentz and Grant Olson with the call because Eric is on vacation. We're looking forward to it. I will see you Saturday night.
Sounds good.
All right. We'll be right. Jeremy Anderson? I forgot the last name.
Coons.
Jeremy Coons. We'll be right back.
Bobfile Boats and Motors is your local Yamaha headquarters. For more than 30 years, Yamaha outboards have delivered far more than superior power, performance, and efficiency. Yamaha owners get something that can't be measured in horsepower or RPM. Legendary Yamaha reliability. Find the Yamaha outboard that fits your life at Bobfile Boats and Motors on Sunset Highway in East Wenatchee or online at bobfile.com.
Caught in a conflict with a family member, in the workplace, or with a neighbor or business? Wenatchee Valley Dispute Resolution Center provides mediation services, a cost-effective and efficient way to provide a written resolution to disputes and issues. Plus, we offer mediation training and community education on topics like conflict resolution and communication skills. Contact us at 509-888-0957 or www.wvdrc.org to learn more.
Hi, everybody. Dan Coots alongside Jesse Coble from Alpine Air. There's ice on my heat pump and under my heat pump.
Well, ice under your heat pump is normal. When we go into a defrost cycle, it melts the frost off, creates water, which freezes to the ground. Ice around your heat pump is a thing that you should probably give us a call about.
Turn to the experts at Carrier and Alpine Air for heat and air. Call Alpine Air. Thanks, Jesse.
Thanks.
Hey there, folks. Blueberry Carrie here to invite you on out to experience Blueberry Hills. Of course, the food is fabulous, like our cheese blintz, our famous French dip, our legendary Eggs Benedict, and unforgettable burgers. But we're more than just great food. People come from all over the world to experience what's been called one of the best destination restaurants in the Pacific Northwest. So come on out and see what all the fuss is about. Blueberry Hills in Manson. It's where the world is coming to.
Getting ready to wrap up a Thursday edition of Wake Up Wenatchee Valley. It is now 69 degrees here in the big city. If you started watching the show an hour ago when the show started, I mentioned when I got up this morning a little after 3, it was 70 degrees. It cooled down to 64, and now the warming process begins. We're in for another day of haze today and about a half the day on Friday, and then the haze is going to dispense and disperse and thin out and go away, but that's going to be replaced with some pretty hot temperatures. Yesterday was warm at 91. Wait till you see the Sunday forecast. But here's one more time that slide from the National Weather Service, just to give you a general idea of what we're in for. Right now, we're still under the influence of that northerly flow. There's that big upper-level ridge that's stationed just off the coast of British Columbia. That's what's been spinning around clockwise, grabbing the smoke from the fires in British Columbia and Alberta and sending it down our way. It's been high and thin haze, but it's been quite noticeable. Well, that's going to change. Low pressure is going to drop down, and that's going to do two things. Number one, it's going to take all that residual smoke that's way up high in the atmosphere, and it'll be clearing out by Friday afternoon. But it's also going to usher in warm air from the southwest, and that means temperatures are going to warm a couple of degrees each day, and they're going to peak on Sunday before we start cooling down a little bit. So from the National Weather Service, after a high of 91 yesterday, 95 today, and that warming will really get going once we get to the noon hour or so. So if you have outdoor plans, do it now. 69, 70, give or take a couple for the overnight low. Again, a hazy Friday morning. Friday afternoon is when that southwesterly flow begins to kick in, and that will scour out the smoke. It actually is going to blow the smoke back up from where it came from, but with the warm air coming from the south, we warm up a couple of degrees to 97 on Saturday, and triple digits certainly within the realm of possibility on Sunday. It is July, you know, slightly cooler Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, but basically sunny and downright hot for the foreseeable future. And that's it for us. Have a good and safe Thursday. We will see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Most fascinating capital cities. That's me, Elizabeth, and today I'm in Germany with my friend Garrett Clayton. We'll tour the town.
This is also known as King Frederick Street. Mm-hmm. Friedrich, known for King Frederick.
And make some amazing discoveries.
You checked out the artwork on this car?
Then we'll uncover some of Berlin's infamous history.
We are standing in front of one of the last remaining pieces of the Berlin Wall.
And put our wall chipping skills to the test.
This is a lot heavier than I thought it was gonna be.
Before adventuring into the town of Potsdam.
So we're here at King Frederick's grave, but why are there potatoes on it?
It's a trip you don't wanna miss. So it's a good thing you're coming with us.
Woo!
Whoa, look at that store over there.
Ooh, let's check it out.
Okay.
Welcome to Elizabeth Stanton's Great Big World in Berlin.
Hey guys, today I'm here in Berlin with my friend Garrett Clayton.
Hi everyone, I am so excited to